stance on the gaming industry. Has that gamble paid off? Hello, I'm Susan Kennedy for Tempo Public Square. You can play the slots in one of 9 casinos throughout Pennsylvania, and soon you might be able to roll the dice. As legislators consider allowing table games, we take a look at the numbers. Has gaming provided property tax relief? Has it filled city coffers with cash to ease those budget woes? And what's the status on new hotels, shops, and other trickle-down development? What's the deal with casinos in the Commonwealth? Right now on Tempo Public Square.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39.
Casino gambling is big business. Since 2004, when slot machines first became legal in the Keystone State, 9 casinos have opened their doors and 3 more have received licenses to operate. Together, they've generated $3 billion in tax revenue. And now, state leaders want to take another gamble, this one on table games. Tempo Public Square's Laura McHugh takes a look at where slots revenue has gone and where the money from table games could end up.
Out of the gates of Hollywood Casino at Penn National Racecourse, these thoroughbreds carry on the proud tradition of horse racing in the Keystone State, a tradition that continues today with the help of slots.
Back before we had the slots revenue, we averaged about 6, 7, maybe 8 horses per race, and right now we average between 9 and 10.
According to Rob Morella, the director of racing, they get not only more horses, but better ones, competing for prizes 3 times as large as they used to be.
Right now, our typical purse is right around $200,000 a night over the course of 9 or 10 races. And 2 years ago, we were looking at $50,000 to $60,000 per night. So that's how dramatically it has increased.
The race course owes its revival in part to the slot machines in the adjacent Hollywood Casino. For every dollar gambled in one of Pennsylvania's 9 casinos, 55 cents goes to taxes and fees.
And the good news is so far that gaming operations and slot machine revenues in Pennsylvania have generated $3 billion over the last 3 years.
According to Greg Flake, the chairman of Pennsylvania's Gaming Control Board, that figure includes $2 billion in property and wage tax relief, $500 million for the horse racing industry, $200 million in economic development projects, $167 million in host fees to the cities and counties where the casinos are located, and $75 million for local fire departments. Facing a state budget deficit of $3.2 billion, state lawmakers have turned once again to the casinos for revenue. This time, many want to add table games like blackjack, poker, and roulette.
Right now, there are 8,000 full-time employees in the casinos. With the advent of table games, Laura, we expect that there will be an additional 6,000 employees in Pennsylvania.
As many as 600 of them may find work in the Lehigh Valley at the Sands Casino Resort Bethlehem. President Bob DeSalvio says they will consider adding 80 to 100 table games to the casino floor, and that each one creates about 6 new jobs.
An average dealer, a starting dealer, probably makes somewhere between $38,000 and $40,000 a year, and that's a combination of their base pay plus tips or gratuities. And with unemployment as bad as it is right now, we think that would really make a significant impact in the Lehigh Valley.
In addition to creating new jobs, chairman of the Las Vegas Sands Corporation, Sheldon Adelson, says table games will give the Bethlehem facility a full deck in competing with the Atlantic City market.
Now, if table games are allowed, we will have the closest, what we call, integrated resort to one of the biggest markets in the United States. So there's a lot of billions of dollars worth of gaming. If we just build a better mousetrap, we'll be a very effective competitor, and we'll make it convention-based, so midweek we'll have reasons for people to come here and fill the hotel rooms.
So far, Adelson's complete vision of a casino, hotel, shopping mall, and convention center has yet to come to fruition. Construction of the hotel stopped in October of 2008, but DeSalvio says the Sands remains committed to completing it.
Our bankers are going to be looking at what kind of future revenue growth that we could have, and certainly the introduction of table games points us in that direction of more profitability, and hopefully at some point in the future they would want to lend the money so that we could finish the project.
That delay in completing the project has affected revenue projections for Bethlehem, Allentown, Lehigh County, and Northampton County.
those initial projections were based on a strong economy and a fully integrated casino project, which is not obviously where we are right now. So we were very careful going into the 09 budget to dial back those expectations and dial back those projections to something much lower.
Bethlehem Mayor John Callahan expects to collect $1.75 million in host fees by the end of the year, but has budgeted $7.4 million worth of revenue for next year, down from the original projections of $9.1 million. The mayor says he looks forward to seeing table games in his local casino, but that decision now rests in the hands of state legislators.
It's going to happen. It's just a matter of the timing of it and the appropriate revenue rate that we're going to get out of the table games.
Representative Doug Reichle voted against slot machines, but explains that gambling revenue has become an option to balance the budget.
We have to find a certain amount of revenue to maintain spending, but if we don't raise people's tax rates, where else do we go? And gambling has become a non-tax revenue option.
For Hollywood Casino's general manager, Frank Wrigley, it all depends on the tax rate lawmakers set.
12% would be wonderful. 34% would not be worth doing it. So we would have to wait and see of where that came out. The lower it is, the likelihood of more games and more jobs and more opportunity for folks there. It's simple. It is just simple arithmetic.
Supporters hope the numbers will add up as well for Pennsylvania's budget and its economy as they have for the horse racing industry.
You need me gets the challenge here from Red Bandera as they turn for the wire. Red Bandera takes charge.
For Tempo Public Square, I'm Laura McHugh reporting.
Thanks so much, Laura. And joining me now are two members of the state's Gaming Oversight Committee. First, Representative Paul Clymer from Bucks County. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you for the invitation.
And Representative Joseph Brennan,
Thank you, Susan.
Of Lehigh and Northampton.
Exactly.
Thanks for being here as
Thank
well.
You, Susan. Thank you.
Now, gentlemen, as Laura's piece says, we are $3 billion richer in this state because of casino gambling. So do you think it's a gamble that has paid off? I'll start with you, Joe.
Yeah, I think, again, I wasn't in the legislature when the legislation passed. Chairman Clymer was, but yes, I think it's been had a significant positive impact in terms of jobs, in terms of the economy, in terms of some economic development situation. So I would have to say it's proven successful so far.
And Representative Clymer, as Joe just said, you've been here a while and you were not pro-gaming when this all first came about. What's your take on the gaming now 5 years in?
As a matter of fact, I opposed the legislation to legalize slots. Some of the problems that I see is the oversight of casino gambling. It's can be very corruptive, crime-infested, and what you have are people who are overspending and they become addicted. And to destroy families, once you do irreparable harm to the families, you hurt the neighborhoods, you hurt the communities, and you cannot have a good quality of life unless you have families that are sticking together. And with all the trials and tribulations in our culture today, the last thing you need is to have gambling as an addiction to create further family problems. And the money that is being used is a discretionary money by people. So gambling does not create any new wealth. It's regressive taxation, quite simply, because you have the disadvantaged, the poor, the less fortunate, who are now spending money that they can ill afford to spend.
But it's here, and it may even grow. And so with that reality, it's $3 billion. And as Laura's piece was breaking it down, let's break down the numbers. $2 billion of the $3 billion that it's brought in has gone to property tax relief. And I'd like to know, has it really brought that relief? And where do I see that on my property tax bill?
Yeah, it has. Every school district, the amounts vary across the state. But if you look closely at your school district tax bill, which you receive in June, mm-hmm. there's a line, a credit, as a result of the gaming property tax relief fund. There's a credit. It varies by school district. Many of our constituents don't realize it. Many times we have to point it out. They don't look at the bill that closely, but there is a reduction, and it's been a significant reduction across the state.
And what is that number, a general number?
It varies by school district. Some school districts are as low as $50, $60 annually. Some school districts, like Allentown, I believe, is around $600 plus. Dollars off on their property
so
tax.
So you can look at the bill and
exactly.
find it. Okay.
When
okay.
the proponents first came out for the legislation to legalize slots, they said this would reduce property tax by 30 to 35%. I have some of those news articles that go back to 2003, 2004. In my legislative districts within the Quakertown, Palisades, and Penrith school districts, we get about $210 average as a reduction. That comes to about 6 to 7%, not the 30 to 35 that has been promised. So it has not fulfilled the obligation that they promised, and I don't see anything in the near future that's going to increase those dollars.
Chairman Clymer is correct, but one of the situations we have in Pennsylvania, all the slot parlors are not open yet. There are two in Philadelphia, and I believe one in Pittsburgh, that are expected to generate significant revenue that have been tied up, either in litigation or just have taken a while to open. So once they're all open, that number, Chairman Clymer is correct, it has not met full expectations, but it's the hope that it will once all the casinos
are
up and running.
What was the number for a year when we were talking about this in 04 and 05? What was the number? We have a reality of $3 billion of tax revenues coming in, but what was the number back then, the hope?
I'm not sure what the dollars were that were being promised, but I do remember what the percentages were, you know, for the property owners. The other issue that you have to keep centered on is that there is a social cost, and you cannot ignore the social cost. I mentioned that just a few minutes ago. And when people have to go on welfare, when there is incarceration, when there are dysfunctional families, there is a cost to that. Society has to pay that cost. And so it's not as though it's free money. And remember this, that if you are using discretionary money and you go buy a refrigerator for $600, you pay a 6% sales tax. When you go to gamble, there is no tax that is collected. The ripple effect in gambling is not as great as though a person goes in and buys that refrigerator where you have a mom and pop store, you have a salesman, you have a manufacturer who has to produce it. In gambling, you spend your money and that's it. Some goes to property tax relief, but the casinos are the ones who make out very handsomely.
Well, it's a for-profit industry, the casinos are, and I think there was a forum in October, and for instance, around the Sands Casino in Bethlehem, I believe some of the people who are around there, the Northampton Community College gentlemen, et cetera, were saying that maybe crime, not even maybe, I think the numbers showed that crime wasn't as bad as they thought it would be with the influx of such a large structure. Certainly, though, I understand your point of the social implications.
And we have the second highest tax rate in the country of those states that have gambling. We're second, I believe, to West Virginia in terms of the tax rate. So we are taxing these dollars at a significant level, second highest in the country.
And let's go back to the numbers. $500 million this past year for the horse racing industry. Of course, not of course, but I've been reading up on this. Pennsylvania now gives more dollars to the horse racing industry than any other state in the country, and it has been a boon, as Laura's piece said, to the horse racing industry. But we're funding a for-profit industry with the for-profit industry when those are tax dollars that could be going at a time to libraries or social programs of which you speak. What's your take on that?
Well, and Chairman Clymer can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe to change that now would be very difficult. The legislation, when it passed, was very specific about the percentages going to the horse racing industry, the percentages to the local municipalities. Mm-hmm. So the legislation specifically dictates that it would be very difficult to change it at this point. Consider some of those worthy things like libraries that you just mentioned.
Well, and in essence, Paul, correct me if I'm wrong, that was the first name of this. That is the name of the bill. It's the horse racing and gaming bill. It all launched that way.
That is correct, and you made a very good point. We're spending hundreds of million dollars for a profit industry, and while we are very generous, there are other services that we should be providing. And libraries, you mentioned, was one of my pet projects, is to make sure that we sustain libraries, but unfortunately that's not the case. And when you talk about the horse racing industry, I wish we could define it just to the racetracks, because so often the proponents will say horse racing and they'll talk about all the horse farms in Pennsylvania, and all the horse farms are not participating in racing. I have a number of horse farms in Upper Bucks County, and yet they're included in the dollar cost and in the feed that is sold to the horses. And so you have to be a little bit more specific, but they are making out quite well, so I will acknowledge that.
And new breeders have come to Pennsylvania, etc. Mm-hmm. Now $200 million in economic development projects. Now we're here by the Sands, where they've actually stalled the hotel and the shopping area for now. Where specifically, what are some big projects that this cash has gone to that you guys are aware of?
There is 5% of the dollars from gambling go to economic development, and there is the Pennsylvania project down in Philadelphia.
The convention center.
Yeah. That is one that is being funded.
By these dollars.
Yes, Allegheny Airport.
Okay.
There is the Penguin Center. All those are being funded by the gaming dollars.
Yeah, okay, and those three projects that Chairman Clymer alluded to, they're absorbing the lion's share of that percentage at this point. But as time goes on, and if this continues to prove successful, you'll see a lot more projects throughout the state that will hopefully garner some funding.
Right. Well, one of the things we'll have to do is we'll have to change the bill to do that, because under the legislation, it points out that the Philadelphia and Pittsburgh are the places where we have to spend the dollars. So there will have to be an agreement to include other municipalities, other counties, to receive some of the benefit.
As they disperse the funds. Okay. Mm-hmm. Sit tight. We have lots more to talk about. We've only scratched the surface, including the rolling the dice on table games. Of course, that's kind of a big thing that's coming up here. And also coming up, she's one of thousands of folks hoping to get a job on the casino floor. And we're going to hear her story coming up next. Now, you may not like gambling, but many folks do like the jobs that come with those casinos. In fact, projections show that table games would create 6,000 new jobs in Pennsylvania. In tonight's My Story, we meet a local woman who's hoping to earn one of those jobs. Roseanne Freed has more than 20 years' experience in the hotel and hospitality industry, and here's her story. My name is Roseanne Freed, and this is My Story. I'm a native Lehigh Valley girl who's been out of the area for 25 years, and now that I'm back, I'm really excited about the concept of gaming tables at the casino. I'm really looking and hoping to be hired there. When I came home to reunite with my family and start a new life here, I was pretty excited about the casino coming to town, because I've always been a hospitality person, I've always been a service person, and I feel like this is a really wonderful opportunity, and this is what my professional forte is, dealing and working with people. I think that this particular job situation and occupation will enable me to give myself a better life, maybe more financial independence. I would like to own a home again. I would like to be a lot more independent, like I always had been. And I really believe that this would afford me that opportunity to do so. I never thought too much about table gaming until last year, when I took a social trip to Atlantic City. And a friend of mine and myself were at the crap table and at the blackjack table. And interestingly enough, there were three or four women who were working these tables. And we started talking. It was interesting to find out that they too were mothers, they were wives, and they were using this as a full-time career, as a profession, and that this job enabled them to do a lot of things that they necessarily would not be able to do. This is the kind of thing that we really need for economic enhancement. I believe that not only will it provide opportunity for myself, but so many other people out there who are looking for the betterment in life, and also for the entertainment. And it's a kind of thing that the Lehigh Valley needs, because it's been a long-awaited concept and theory, and now it's being developed, hopefully, and into an actuality. And my name is Roseanne Freed, and this is my story. Thanks so much, Roseanne. And now we welcome back Representatives Clymer and Brennan. Paul Clymer, Joseph Brennan, thanks for being here. Now, what about Roseanne's hope to get a job at the table games? What is the status in Harrisburg with that?
Well, currently the legislation to legalize table games is tied up in Senate Bill 711. One of the problems I have with that legislation is that the Rendell administration has tied that in with the reform. As I mentioned before, we need to do reform legislation. That is critical, and that goes back to the year 2004. So we've gone 5 years, and we're still trying to fix the 2004 Act. so that's where the bill lies. I have some amendments I want to put in regarding table games. I don't think there should be free drinks. I think that even the employees of the casinos say we should not be giving out free drinks. There's still too much smoking that is done, which is disadvantage both to the patrons and to the employees, because secondhand smoke can be very harmful. So those are the issues that that I'm looking at right now. If we want to expand the business base, then let's provide for tax incentives for the small businesses, for training, give them tax benefits for health care, for purchasing new equipment. Let's provide the necessary finances and regulations, less regulations for small businesses, so that they can expand and grow, and so that people like Rosemary can find employment. I do sympathize with her. I do realize that she wants to start a life again, and coming back to the beautiful Lehigh Valley is a good place to begin. But there is a better way to do it than the casinos.
Go ahead, Jim.
The good news is for Mrs. Fried, I think the legislation is going to be enacted soon, hopefully by Christmas. It is being discussed. The sticking points now are the licensing fee and the tax rate.
And what numbers are we tossing around, Joe? I've heard 12%. I've heard three times that.
The Senate proposal, I believe, was 12%. The House proposal was 34%. We're probably, from what I'm hearing, going to wind up somewhere in the middle between 15 and 17%. With a, I believe, approximately a $15 million licensing fee. So again, the good news for people like Mrs. Fried looking for employment, these table games probably will be up and running by next June.
And tell me again, review for all of us, the casinos get taxed on each table game that is entered, much like they're taxed on each slot machine that is there. And then in addition, there's a cut taken from what's earned throughout the day. Explain,
there's a tax on the gross net earnings, the money that's left at the end of the day for each table game. And as Joe had rightly said, there is some disagreement as to what that tax should be. Currently, for the slot machines, it's 34% that goes to property tax relief. I think the figure for table games should go up to at least 20 to 25%, and a license should begin at $25 million if they're going to get a license for table games. And let me tell you why. We provided $50 million license for casinos. But I can tell you that when Harrah's bought 50% of the Chester Downs, they paid $250 million. And when Hollywood Casino bought out the second Penn National license, they paid, I think it was around $210 million. So these are expensive licenses, and we gave them a break at $50 million. Let's not give away the store by giving them such a low figure. You know, $25 million for a license, for a table license, is very reasonable.
But conversely, one of the reasons that the licenses were sold at what many consider a reasonable rate of $50 million was that our tax rate, as I said earlier, is the second highest in the country. We're taxing at a total, I believe, of 55% on the slots. We're probably going to wind up somewhere between 15 and 17 on the table games. Right. 30% tax on the table games will not create the kind of jobs, the amount of jobs, or the economic the ancillary economic development. You talked earlier, Susan, about the Sands. You see that the hotel portion is now bagged over to protect it from the elements. If we get table games in, I think we'll see a lot more progress on not only the hotel and the conference center, but also the other retail and commercial stuff down on that brownfield, the largest in the country.
Exactly, and so and that continues to be the challenge. It really is a cash cow, casinos and gaming. And so if that all comes in, it's almost, it's a direct feed to redevelopment. But then there's the checks and balances. Mm-hmm. Your colleague, Doug Reichle, had said the same thing. I mean, he voted against casinos, but then, you know, they're here to stay, so we need to manage it better. Would you agree?
Yeah, and that is one of the, going back to Senate Bill 711, mm-hmm. my problem is that I want to vote for the reforms, but I do not want to vote for the legalization of table games. And the governor has now put another caveat in it, and he said if you do not vote for the table games, which is to sustain the budget that was just passed, the four universities, state-related universities, will not get any funding. That's Temple, Penn State, Pitt, mm-hmm. and Lincoln. And that's wrong, too, to hold hostage the universities until we pass table games. And look at the equity that the casinos are going to build up when they do the if table games is approved. Now their operations become much more valuable. So we have to consider that increase in equity and value with the license, because it's a one-time deal. Once we do it, it's done. The other thing, the Patriot News just recently ran an article about what people are being paid, will be paid in central Pennsylvania for the for working at table games, $6-7 an hour. That's what they get, but they get tips. So if the tips are not there, you know, those high salaries that we constantly hear about are not going to materialize. And during a recession, is this the way you want to create economic opportunity, by taking money from the people, many who cannot ill afford to gamble? And we call that economic development. I have serious problems.
Well, we've had arguments in front of our gaming oversight committee, which Paul and I both serve on, Paul being the former chairman of the committee, and that issue was brought up. How much are these jobs actually going to pay at the tables? And they do. They pay $6 to $9 an hour. But when you include the tips, generally speaking, these people make over $20 an hour. And again, in an economy right now where we're looking at 10.2% unemployment, we need to do all we can to foster good-paying jobs with benefits and economic development opportunities, and putting construction workers back to work,
and too. Everyone back to work. Real quick, we have like 15 seconds. Gaming Oversight Committee is not the Gaming Control Board. Joe, explain.
It's a committee that considers any legislation, a House committee that considers any legislation that deals with any changes in gaming, current gaming legislation.
Okay. Thanks.
We do not do the work of the gaming board.
Okay. And for more information on all that, first let me thank you both, Joseph Brennan and Representative Paul Clymer. Thanks so much for being here and clarifying all these issues out there. Appreciate it so much. If you want to learn more about the Gaming Commission and the Gaming Control Board, et cetera, and the difference between the two, and keep an update on what's happening with both of those committees, you can log on to WLVT.org, click on Tempo Public Square. And be sure to join us next time as we explore some more public policy issues. We'll see you next time. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39.